Welcome back. What are the practices and institutions we would look for when you want to measure the democracies? They are free and fair elections, open public debates on major policies and legislations, and citizens' right to information about the government and its functioning. In a democracy, the fundamental rights of the citizens are protected by the Constitution. Citizens have the right to join political parties and other organizations. The media in a democratic form of government is known as the fourth pillar of democracy, as they watch the government's every move and criticize it if any misstep is taken. Political control in a country is provided through free and fair elections, with two or more political parties being involved. The head of the country in a democratic government is the one who gets the most support in the form of votes in a general election. They also have the additional responsibility of ensuring the welfare of the electorate. In a dictatorship, no elections take place or they are heavily regulated by restricting the number of political parties and limiting gatherings and associations. In a dictatorship, one individual is the sole authority of the country with no institution to keep its power in check. The media is the mouthpiece of a dictatorial government. Regardless of what a dictator does, the media will always show what needs to be shown to the masses so that a cult of personality is always maintained. In a dictatorship, little importance is given to fundamental rights, with the populace being generally subjected to constant policing, monitoring, and brutality. A democratic government is the people's own government. People wish to be ruled by representatives elected by them. Democracy produces a responsive government where people start taking actions when the government becomes insensitive about their aspirations. There, people can force the government to respond to them through protest, campaigns, and rallies. Democratic governments also do not have a very good record when it comes to sharing information with citizens. They often frustrate the needs of the people and often ignore the demands of a majority of its population. The routine tales of corruption are enough to convince us that democracy is not free of this evil. We can only say that it is much better than any non-democratic regimes in these respects. There is one respect in which democratic government is certainly better than its alternatives. Democratic government is legitimate government. Here, legitimacy denotes a system of government. It may be slow, less efficient, not always very responsive or clean, but a democratic government is people's own government. That's why there is an overwhelming support for the idea of democracy all over the world. Thus, we can say that democracy produces an accountable, responsive, and legitimate government. Economic growth and development. If you consider all democracies and all dictatorships for the last 50 years, dictatorships have slightly higher rate of economic development. There is a significant difference in the rates of economic growth between countries under dictatorship and democracy, but democracy is preferred as it has several other positive outcomes. What are the economic outcomes of democracy? Dictatorial regime has had a slightly better record of economic growth when we compare their record only in poor countries. Similarly, there are evidences of very high degree of inequalities within democratic countries. For example, in democratic countries like South Africa and Brazil, the top 20 people take away more than 60% of the national income. They leave only less than 4% of the national income for the bottom 20% population. There is often inequality of opportunities available to the poorer sections. It doesn't mean that industrialized countries can afford democracy, but the poor countries need dictatorship to become rich. There is no relationship between democracy and the wealth of the nation. The economic development of the nation is dependent upon the resources, the policies, and the openness of the government to attract investment. If the dictatorship could have brought wealth in the nation, countries like Nigeria would be having all rich people, which is not the case in reality. So if we base our verdict on economic performance of democratic regimes in terms of growth and equal distribution alone, then it is not satisfactory. But we have to remember that democracy is just a form of government. It can only create conditions for achieving something. The citizens have to take advantage of those conditions and achieve those goals. As you have already studied in economics, economic development depends upon several factors like the country's population size, global situation, cooperation from other countries, economic priorities adopted by the country, etc. There is often inequality of opportunities available to the poorer sections of the society. Let us see, how is reduction of inequality and poverty in democracies? Perhaps more than development, it is reasonable to expect democracies to reduce economic disparities. Democracies are based on political equality. All individuals have equal weight in electing representatives. In the process of bringing individuals into the political arena on an equal footing, we find growing economic inequalities in democratic countries. A small number of ultra-rich enjoy a highly disproportionate share of wealth and incomes. Their share in the total income of the country has been increasing. The poor sections of the society have very little to depend upon, and their incomes have been declining. In class 9 economics, you have studied about poverty in India. The situation is much worse in some other countries. In Bangladesh, more than half of its population lives in poverty. A large number of farmers are committing suicides in different states of India because of the economic inequality in the country. Farmers in villages grow crops on a small piece of land. And if the weather conditions do not stay stable, the farmer has to suffer serious loss. He is further unable to repay the loan taken from the money lender or the bank and gets overburdened by the loan. These cases have increased in the country over the past few years. And the poor farmers take such severe steps like committing suicide. The government should provide these farmers with cheap fertilizers and seeds and provide them with better irrigation methods. In actual life, democracies do not appear to be very successful in reducing economic inequalities, because there are sectional communities which have different professions. Income equality is not a value of democracy, as democracy brings social and political equality. People have the right to vote and can access fundamental rights, but income is self-generated and that depends on their ability to work. Accommodation of social diversity. Do democracies lead to peaceful and harmonious life among citizens? We have seen in the earlier chapters how democracies accommodate various social divisions. We saw in the first chapter how Belgium has successfully negotiated differences among ethnic groups. No society can fully and permanently resolve conflicts among different groups. But we can learn to respect these differences and we can evolve mechanisms to negotiate the differences. Democracy is best suited to produce this outcome. Ability to handle social differences, divisions and conflicts is a plus point of democratic regimes. Hitler was a dictator, and you may remember how different social groups and minorities suffered under Nazi regime. But the example of Sri Lanka reminds us that democracy must fulfill two conditions in order to achieve this outcome. What are the conditions under which democracies accommodate social diversities? Social diversities can be accommodated by focusing on all the communities of the society. The majority and minority communities should be given equal attention. In democratic countries, both the majority and minority communities work together to achieve progress and development of the nation. The majority always needs to work with the minority so that governments function to represent the general view. Rule by majority does not become rule by majority community in a country in terms of religion or race or linguistic group, etc. Majority rule is a means for organizing government. Under the majority system, the party or candidate winning more than 50% of the vote in a constituency is awarded the contested seat. In democratic India, the party winning more than 50% of the seats organizes the government. One who gets the most support or majority in the general election becomes the head of the country in a democratic government. It means any person or group may become a majority in a democracy. From the above discussion, we can understand that it will be a fair expectation that democracy should produce harmonious social life. Let us now look at dignity and freedom of the citizens in democracies. Democracy stands much superior to any other form of government in promoting the dignity and freedom of the individual. Every individual wants to receive respect from fellow beings. The passion for respect and freedom are the basis of democracy. Let's take the case of the dignity of women. Most societies across the world were male-dominated societies. The long struggles by women have created some sensitivity that respect and equal treatment of women are necessary ingredients of a democratic society. Democracies throughout the world have recognized this, at least in principle. That does not mean that women are actually always treated with respect. But once the principle is recognized, it becomes easier for women to protest against what is not acceptable. In a non-democratic setup, the principle of individual freedom and dignity would not have the legal and moral support. The same is true of caste inequalities. Democracy in India has strengthened the claims of the disadvantaged and discriminated caste for equal status and equal opportunity. Most individuals today believe that their vote make a difference to the way the government is run and to their own self-interest. Democratic examination never gets over. As it passes one test, it produces another test. As people get some benefits of democracy, they ask for more and want to make democracy even better. The fact is that people are complaining. That itself is a testimony to the success of democracy. It shows that people have developed awareness and the ability to expect and to look critically at power holders. A public expression of dissatisfaction with democracy shows the success of the democratic project. It transforms people to the status of citizens. Hope this explanation has helped you to evaluate the functioning of democracies and the outcomes of democracy. Keep learning and stay tuned for further updates. Thank you. Thank you for watching.